It's great to be back. I was recording very, very good videos, very long ones, and the Wi-Fi connection would drop out and I'd lose the entire thing. So I got dejected and said, what can I do? Well, I've got it hardwired now with a cable outside. So hopefully this will not be lost into the ether. I'll start out by talking about the world situation. And my comment would be that we're in over our heads. We don't understand to what extent we're being manipulated here on this planet right now. Jiddu Krishnamurti in the 50s gave a forecast of these times and said, told us basically, we would be in over our heads, that there would be an influx into this world of a different type of makeup, mental makeup, and that along with other factors would lead to a sort of a tyranny of the mind, so to speak, here. And he said, he warned us that we would need to travel as fast as possible towards truth in order to escape this trap, and indeed here we are. But the actual dynamics of this planet right now have come about due to what I call extraterrestrial participation. And really, it's been a takeover of this world by certain groupings of extraterrestrials who want this planet for themselves. They have plans for it. They, you know, it's kind of like driving through a neighborhood and they see a nice house and they say, ah, I want to buy that house. How much is it? Well, there has been a takeover, and those who have engineered this takeover are very experienced, very clever, very strategic, and very adept at termiting the barricades to keep them out, keep them from succeeding at this. And so, well, they have succeeded. They really have succeeded, and it's alarming to look at the news and to see the red flags and to see what's really taking place. It's truly almost paralyzing, because it feels like there's nothing we can do, nothing that can be done. There's horrible false egoic belief system has become amplified in this world. And we are being taught, programmed through just massive propaganda in very clever ways. The world has been infiltrated through and through. And so, as I say again, we are in over our heads. And it's the wise who recognize this. So my contemplations have been in that direction of just realizing that there's nothing that anyone can do at this point. It's a lost cause. Now, interestingly enough, as we keep an open mind, and let me speak to keeping an open mind for just a minute, because that is crucial. If you want to know truth, you have to have a certain type of ability to have an open mind, an open seeing, without instant rejection. Now, let me use my own situation as an example here. I can speak directly to this because my history has been as a musician, not only this life, but previous lives. And a musician, I think it was someone said that a really good musician is a very talented thief, in that they steal ideas from everywhere and then blend them together and add a dash of their own originality and inspiration and come up with something. A musician has to listen to many different songs, many different styles, with an open mind, saying, what can I get out of this song? What can I find? They cannot just reject things a priori. Just say, well, this singer, I don't like the way they look. I don't like their presentation. I just prejudge them, prejudge it. The musician will say, okay, well, let's take a listen to this song. And they'll keep an open mind, open ears. Maybe open ears is better. Keep open ears to what is being said. Doesn't mean you have to accept everything. And nobody will. Someone asked me, who is Jesus? And the truth is that every single person has a different perspective. Every single person on this planet has a different perspective on who Jesus is. So it's useless to try and answer such a question. But each, whatever is said, each one can listen with open ears and gain some crucial insights. As I say, we're in over our head. That's a generalized statement. It's not a statement that will lead to disputation, really. It's a general statement that one can feel intuitively and say, you know what, I feel that too. I feel that what's going on this planet is way deeper than I realize, than anyone realizes, really. And it's being orchestrated at a level that we cannot really get at. It's too sophisticated, it's too advanced, it's too clever. It's like somebody is just playing us like a drum. And we need to have the humility to realize that there are extraterrestrials who are way, way, way more advanced than human civilization. And have had a lot of practice taking over civilizations, infiltrating them. Now, here's where the open ears need to come into play. Because I'm going to speak somewhat from the scriptures, the Bible, and what some people have a knee-jerk reaction to one way or the other. Either taking everything completely literally or rejecting everything that was said there. But the truth is, you need to have the voice of reason place everything in the right context. So in the scriptures, those scriptures really come from tremendous experience and sophistication cosmically. Not just this planet, but cosmically, knowing the cycles of existence, knowing the politics of the cosmos, and knowing how various extraterrestrials, how they move about, what they do, their tactics, their ways and means, and their agendas, their goals, their purposes. And it was a warning to us, a warning to this world. It was a warning about what's going to happen, because it's easy to foresee various things in the world, in the cosmos, that happen based on cycles, based on intentions. And so we were warned that this world would be taken over. And those times are called the end times, where the world would literally be in the grasp of Satan, which I would say in the grasp of a deep forgetfulness of what we are. Very intense, deep forgetfulness and an intention to deepen that forgetfulness. That's what is classically termed Satan or the devil, is a deep forgetfulness of what we are, with the purpose of deepening it even more and perpetuating it, even to the point of endless perpetuation. And a belief system and a civilization and a structure which facilitates this. And the scriptures call us the kingdom of the flesh. Kingdom of the flesh. Okay. This world has literally been turned in the direction of the kingdom of the flesh, setting up the kingdom of the flesh here. And it's an all-encompassing perspective. And the operatives that have been working to bring this into place have managed to gain a sacred cow status in this world, on this planet. They're irreproachable, beyond reproach, cannot be criticized. And so here we are, with the purpose of gaining a complete and perfect remembrance of what we are right now. And we're faced with a planet that has been structured now to bring a deep and enduring forgetfulness of what we are, and to pursue that to the utmost by setting up the kingdom of the flesh here. So we're faced, we're in over our heads because the world is in a fever, like a virus. It's like a virus that has gripped the planet. Everywhere you look, there seems to be this collapse of will in the world to reject this. Now, how do ETs manage to do this? It's very interesting the way the cosmos works. And it works a lot of, very similar to the way this world works as far as countries. Just substitute for countries, substitute planets, other dwelling places. And there are many dwelling places in the cosmos. Here among countries, there's all sorts of conflict, there's all sorts of treaties to keep things in check. Sometimes there's open conflict, and then that'll cease, and there'll be treaties, and there'll be alliances. There'll be agreements that this is the way we're going to do it. You get to do this much, and we get to do that much. It's all this instability that is kind of held together with baling wire of agreements and treaties, etc. Same thing in the cosmos. ETs are very conflicted with one another, but they have all sorts of treaties, agreements. Trade agreements, business agreements, territorial agreements, resource agreements, economic agreements, all these things. And so in order to infiltrate a planet, the group of ETs cannot break the treaties that they have with other groups. They can't just come in here with might and take over like that. They have to subtly infiltrate it. And there's been some videos on YouTube explaining how this works. It's very true that they have to be invited in and have to follow certain protocols in order to not violate treaties they have with other ET groups and risk war, risk sanctions, severe sanctions and conflict. So it's a very clever dance that takes place. And yet it has taken place. And the world did invite certain groups in. They made treaties with them. And they made trade agreements with them for technology in exchange for access. And gradually the laws of the land have been changed. Gradually the children of the world have been brainwashed through the media and television, popular culture, and through education and through the laws, have been taught and educated, brainwashed is really a much better term, about how to think, about what is right, etc., etc. And all of these attitudes now actually play right into the hands of setting up the kingdom of the flesh, Satan's kingdom here on earth. A place where, an ideal place to come and forget what one really is, which is a spirit. It's imperishable, invulnerable, uncorruptible, eternal, immaculate spirit. That is what we are. And we come here to forget this. And this planet is being custom designed to provide an even more powerful experience of forgetting. It's already almost a totally perfect place to forget, but now it's being made into even more attractive. It's like gilding the lily, is putting gold on the patina of even more attractiveness. And it's a horrible thing. It's a nightmare for those who want to awaken. It's an absolute nightmare because it's the will. I mean, just being able to compare these times now to 50 years ago is incomparable. Cannot even compare. It's so far, so different. Those who are only here recently really don't have any idea. They have to take my word for it, and others. The will back then to reject the kingdom of the flesh was still very much, very strong. And the things that today that are completely accepted without prejudice, without comment, as if this is just the way it's supposed to be, were back then unthinkable. Nobody even remotely considered these things. It was just a given that there's no way in the world that anything like this could take root. It's like if you have a beautiful garden, you don't let the weeds grow. You don't sit there and say, well, I think I'm just going to let all these nasty weeds grow in my garden. No, that's unthinkable. The dedicated and devoted gardener doesn't stand for that at all. If a weed pokes its head up, it's pulled out. The gardener does not tolerate all kinds of weeds in their garden. They grow the beautiful, fragrant, fruitful plants and keep the invasive, destructive weeds out, the ones that want to choke off all the beautiful plants. They get rid of them. They don't allow them to flourish. They don't fertilize them. They don't water them. That's the wise gardener. And yet in today's world, the weeds are cultivated and fertilized and given precedence, and the fruitful plants are neglected, no water given to them. They're withering up, dying. Bizarre, bizarre situation. But not so unexpected, because in scriptures, these times are predicted. It was known that there's certain groups, ETs, that had aimed to take over this planet, and they had the ways and the means to do so, and they would do so. Very foreseeable. So those who took the warning seriously were not caught entirely by surprise. I was not caught entirely by surprise by any means. It's a funny thing. Back in the 60s and early 70s, we were taught to not trust the media. The mood of the time was to see all the tricks that the media played, to see through them. And I literally had a class in high school that was brilliant, you know, taught us all the tricks of the trades and how deceptive the media could be. And the funny thing was, it was because at that time the media was pretty much controlled by large corporations and trying to turn everybody into a certain direction, control the population. Whereas now the media has a different control. Yet the media is still extraordinarily manipulative. But at an early age, you know, my generation really did not trust advertising and marketing and media. And from that groundwork, it was possible to, you know, distrust authority, distrust all of these ways of manipulation. And then some of us took this even further and began to see deeper and deeper and deeper into the planet and how it's manipulated. And this eventually led for some to literally be able to see how the extraterrestrials infiltrated this planet, how they use the media, how they use entertainment, how they use the legal system, how they use politicians, how they put on the song and dance for the world, how they use educational system, how they brainwash the planet. And many people feel it, and they're upset and angry with it. But again, they don't realize that they're in over their heads. Everyone is in over their heads. These entities have a bag of tricks that is really very endless, and they're ruthless, very ruthless. And they cannot be reasoned with. I've had interactions on various levels with these entities opposing them, and they cannot be reasoned with. They have a sense of entitlement that is completely insane, that they feel that what they're doing is manifest destiny. Pretty much like the USA has felt what it does is manifest destiny. The ETs believe what they're doing is manifest destiny. They totally believe in it. They feel what they're doing is the will of God. Setting up the kingdom of the flesh is somehow, it's the will of the ego, actually. But they don't realize that the God that they are following is the ego. It's not a God at all. It's really the advice the mind is feeding us to forget about God, because our desire is to be prime creator. The desire of the ETs is to be prime creator. That's the desire that gave rise to existence. Spirit had this desire to be prime creator. Therefore, it had to forget about God, which is the actual prime creator, and throw in a substitute. And the mind feeds spirit guidance about how to forget about the Prime Creator, how spirit can forget about itself. And this constant feeding of guidance, we wrongly attribute this to God, the Prime Creator, when it's actually the mind presenting the idea that we gave the mind, the idea of trying to be Prime Creator. That's what's actually feeding us all this guidance in existence. It's the ego, we call it. The mind. But again, the mind is the servant of spirit. It's the servant of the ideas that spirit chooses. Mind is not a free agent. So spirit chooses the idea of wanting to be Prime Creator. Mind has to feed it guidance on how to forget what it is, how to forget reality, how to forget God, the Prime Creator. And that is existence. That's the scenario we are experiencing. And so these ETs, they feel, they believe they're following the will of God, but they're following the will of the ego. The guidance of the mind is giving them how to forget the Prime Creator, how to forget what they truly are. And therefore, the ego is telling them how to set up this kingdom of the flesh here on this planet. And they are actually following that advice in a very self-righteous way, believing that it's manifest destiny. This is the will of God, and this is what must and will happen here. And they're completely immersed in this belief system. And you cannot make any headway with them and trying to broaden their scope and see the delusion that they're under, and how setting up the kingdom of the flesh is actually a very, very harmful thing, very bad thing to do. They feel their motto is that tolerance brings peace. Okay, that's the motto of the ego. When you hear that word tolerance, that's the ego. Because what the ego is saying, that if you tolerate its guidance and do what it tells you to do to set up deep forgetfulness of what we are, that's the only way we can find peace, is in the supreme forgetfulness of what we really are. The ego gives us that belief. It says it's possible to perfectly forget what we are, and when we finally reach that perfect forgetfulness, we will find perfect peace, because we will then be Prime Creators. This is a lie. This is a deception. That path of tolerance means tolerating the ego's guidance, tolerating setting up the kingdom of the flesh here on this planet. That should not be tolerated. That should be rejected. That should not be nourished and fertilized. It should be rejected. Light doesn't tolerate darkness. When light shines, the darkness, where is the darkness? It vanishes. Truth doesn't tolerate lies. Where there's truth, there are no lies. There are no lies in truth whatsoever. So, this planet for a long time was intolerant of the setting up the kingdom of flesh here, which is the right thing. Because we literally have to give up the notion of trying to be Prime Creator, because we can't succeed at it, and we're miserable at it. And God is calling to us, it's inherently we're attracted to remember what we are. We want to function as we were created to function, and we will. But we have to drop this idea of wanting to be Prime Creator, choose a different idea, the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator. We have to do that. Every aspect of spirit must do that, because there's nowhere else to go. Because the idea of forgetting what spirit is a futile idea that goes nowhere. And spirit will inevitably reject it, say this is nonsense. So the only issue we have is one of delay. It's the only issue we face here. Setting up the kingdom of forgetfulness, the kingdom of flesh, Satan's kingdom in this world, only delays will bring us delay. Only will bring us misery, great misery. Those who are setting up this kingdom are being worshipped in this world right now. They're the heroes, the champions, the ones who bring in that song and dance of decadence into the world. They're seen as irreproachable and wonderful. But they're really bringing misery to us. Misery into this world. Terrible, terrible delay and suffering. And so it should be rejected. But the will to reject it in this world has been gutted step by step by step by step by step. Law after law after law after law is literally criminalizing rejection of the satanic kingdom of the flesh here, setting that up. And so those who reject this are literally being criminalized. That is actually the direction that is taking place, which is why you're hearing less and less and less and less of this. It's like a straitjacket, an octopus of legal entanglements for anyone who dares to oppose the setting up of this kingdom of flesh, this place of extreme forgetfulness of what we are, this place of misery, this place of delay. That's literally what is taking place. Every day, there's a whole new set of mandates and laws and restrictions and declarations and programs and everything, spin, which demonizes the entire notion of not tolerating the setting up of this kingdom of the flesh here. Whereas in the past, everyone had a basic common will to reject this Satan's kingdom. It's a common will that we all shared. And it was a good, positive feeling. It was a feeling like we are going in the right direction towards remembrance. And this collective will, it's not an individual, it's a collective will. We all kind of helped each other out with this. I mean, in other words, we would frown on any deviation from this. We would frown on it. We would lovingly, kindly, gently, but firmly say, you know, no, this isn't going to work here in our collective will to remember what we are. Now it's been reversed 180 degrees. Now there's a collective frowning on anyone who speaks out against the setting up the kingdom of the flesh here. And there's a great support and nourishment of all those who are working frantically to set this kingdom of the flesh up here on this planet. It's a tragedy beyond words, actually. And again, we're in over our heads here because those who are doing this know their business extremely well. And I think we had a false sense of security on this planet because so many people were not strongly devoted to remembering what they are. What they really are. They kind of just sort of went along with it because it was the fashion of the time, so to speak. But you know, how when one is converted, let's say, to this path, at the point of a sword, point of a gun, because of losing some battle, etc., how deep is that conviction, really? How deep is that conversion? And way too many conversions to this viewpoint of remembering what one is has taken place out of economic and military and political necessity, just the need to survive, losing battles and having to convert. And that does not make for a stable foundation. So those who were simply wishy-washy, on the fence, not really deeply converted towards truth, they've all fallen away. They've collapsed. Their will has collapsed. It's like a bridge collapsing because it wasn't put on a stable foundation. So we never really had the will in this world, as much will as we thought, to reject additional delay. And that's why it was able to take root in this world. So many people have just caved in. Their will was not strong enough because the foundations were not built on a strong enough, you know, conviction. One has to have a glimpse of reality to have a strong enough conviction to reject the vice of the ego. Because the vice of the ego is self-referencing. And if you don't have any reference outside of the ego's belief system, you got no chance. And when the ego decides to move in on you and put the screws on you, you're going to collapse. And we're seeing that in the world. I see a collapse of the collective will of this planet. It's already happened. It's like a train wreck right in front of our eyes, and it's unwatchable for me. And those who used to be able to speak freely about truth and admonishing the collective will here to stay on the straight and narrow path, They now feel extremely guilty and fearful of even speaking up, raising their voices at all. It's amazing. So I go about and I see things, I feel like I should speak up, and I feel this tremendous dread, like, you don't dare say that, you'll be set upon, like a pack of wolves will set upon you. That you'll be labeled crazy, a nutcase, when you're merely admonishing the world to stay on the straight and narrow path towards remembrance, something that is completely basic and primary. That one should not even have to mention, justify it, or defend it at all. And yet here it's become indefensible. Thanks to our friends and neighbors, certain groups of ETs who are very, very instrumental in bringing about this change. They're suffering from severe, severe forgetfulness of what they truly are. And they're suffering from enormous spiritual pride, believing that they can become prime creators. And they see this as taking over this world as a stepping stone to that. They're very much into the flesh, kingdom of the flesh, bodies, what bodies can do, human potential, entertainment, emotion, human drama. That's the kingdom of the flesh. And all the diversions and perversions of the flesh, they're totally into all of that, all the drugs, all the modifications, all the stuff based on luck, all the gaming, luck, gambling, drinking, drugs, all the pornography, the ETs brought that in. All these things that focus us on the flesh, what that does is it brings a deep forgetfulness of what we are, because we're not the flesh at all. Flesh has got nothing to do with what we are. It's a picture, opposite picture, like a picture of darkness. Black darkness, inky darkness. There's no light at all. And we're looking at that and we're trying to, believing that's what we are. As we pay attention to the flesh, we believe that's what we are. Because where our attention is, that's what we believe is us. So, everything that's emphasized in this world now used to be de-emphasized. When I grew up, you know, so many things that were unthinkable, like gambling, absolutely unthinkable. The only place in gambling in the U.S. was in Nevada, which was, you know, to us that was absolutely reprehensible. And we literally believed that there would never, ever be any gambling in the United States. It was an impossibility. Now look at it. Now we literally are subsidizing our entire school system through lotteries and gambling, which would be 100% unbelievable when I grew up, in the era that I grew up. That would be totally inconceivable. We would laugh. If someone said that would take place, we would laugh at them like they were just absolutely out of their minds. Almost everything about this modern culture was literally inconceivable in the past. Tattoos are another thing. Where I grew up, nobody had tattoos. The only people that had tattoos were sailors, that's it. Or convicts. Gang members, maybe. Not even them. Then maybe they have a few, yeah. It was a criminal thing. And now, it's like criminality has become fashionable. Everyone wants to identify with criminality or the kingdom of the flesh. It's really literally a stamp solidifying allegiance to the kingdom of the flesh, Satan's kingdom. When I grew up in my era, nobody had tattoos. Nobody even remotely considered it as a possibility. It was literally unthinkable. Unthinkable. Because we understood what it stood for. We understood that. We very much understood and realized that path is absolutely, we have zero interest in going down that path. Same with pornography. We understood it was very wicked, very ruinous, very bad influence. And it was just unthinkable. Rejected, very strongly rejected. And the same people who brought the internet into this world also brought all the pornography and the whole thing is part of this kingdom of the flesh. All the vices have been brought in and are celebrated now, as if like some kind of hip coolness. You know, like this is like being with it, being with the times, being contemporary, completely overlooking the fact that it is taking the world on a ruinous direction. Direction of great suffering and misery, great regrets. Some say that grace is always working in this world. Everything that happens is for the good. It's not true. I don't see it that way. I understand that there's a certain perspective, a way of looking at things like that. But the fact is, this planet has been suffered enormous, enormous damage, and an institutionalization of delay here, which is a very bad thing. It's not grace at all. It's the opposite. It's very harmful. Harmful in the fact that it will cause so many great suffering and misery down the road. Because the road that the world is going down now, down that road, that's a dark, dark, dark road. There's no light on that road. And the voices of those who have tried to warn the world of this, of which I have been a part of my whole life, those voices have been ignored and have been ridiculed and marginalized. And some people, if they had enough clout, were tolerated to a certain extent and listened to politely. But nobody really expected this, and now it's too late. We got caught unawares almost. I think we underestimated the tenacity and the cleverness of those who wanted to bring this world in the wrong direction. And I say wrong, because it is the wrong direction. It's a direction of futility. It's a direction of impossibility. It's a direction of delusional belief that we can be prime creator. It's a direction of celebrating insanity, as if through celebrating it magically, it can turn into sanity. That's the wrong direction. We should not tolerate the wrong direction. There's this insanity of tolerating, of tolerance, is causing the garden to turn into a weed patch. And it's a collective will thing. There's a saying, hate the sin, but love the sinner. Even now, in today's world, hate has become a crime. So in order to hate the sin, that's called intolerance, which is a crime now. Severe crime. Those are satanic laws that have been put in place that are custom designed to feed, to allow this kingdom of the flesh to be entrenched here, to be deeply rooted here, and to be celebrated here, as if celebrating insanity can magically bring about, make insanity the new sanity. It will never happen. It will never, never happen. Impossible that can ever happen, which is all I've been saying my whole life to everyone in this world, and broadcasting that through my intentions, that it's impossible. It will never happen. It's a road of futility. That's a sweeping statement. So if you know that, why would you tolerate stupidity and delay? It's really intolerable. It's not something that should be tolerated. I tell you this, suffering, there's a point where suffering does become intolerable. At that point, you will truly regret having tolerated that path which took you towards the intolerable. And when you reach the intolerable, then you turn around and then you've got a long path back. Fortunately, you have the voice of reason to help you along that path and shorten the path for you. But it's an amazing thing that nobody's listening. Almost no one is listening now in this world. There are people, both of all age groups and all inclinations, that do listen, that can hear a bit, have open ears. Maybe they were musicians at some point in time. Good business people, good anyone who wants to be successful has to have open ears. They need to learn from others. They need to have a wide panoramic influx of awareness and be very generally wise. So open ears is crucial for this. And so many in this world no longer have open ears. That is the ultimate tragedy, is I've noticed that the way that people are brainwashed now is they don't have open ears. They're taught certain, they're taught what's called zero tolerance, which means no open ears at all. Means they know what they're supposed to be intolerant of, and they don't tolerate that at all. In other words, they're intolerant of truth. They're intolerant of any viewpoint other than what the ego's guidance is telling them. The ego pursues this zero tolerance policy towards the voice of reason, towards truth. Has to do that to set up this kingdom. Otherwise, we would quickly reject the ego. So the ego literally has to put this draconian, totalitarian, fascist system of control over the planet. Zero tolerance towards any rejection of the ego and its plans. And that's what's happening. So you cannot have an open discussion under those situations when people of the world have closed ears. They cannot listen and say, yeah, you know what? I like some of that. When you listen to music, you know, you might like, there might be a passage, a riff, a certain phrase, that's really nice. You say, ah, that hits the spot. That really hits the spot. I like that. I like that twang there. You know, I like the way they move into the song or go into this verse. I like the way they segue, you know, into this and that. And there are all sorts of things that you can find if you look for it. Little nuggets of sparkling. Say, ah, this is really nice. It's listening with open ears, giving the courtesy. I've certainly listened to what the ego had to say with open ears, and I found out it was mistaken. Totally mistaken. But I did give the respect and courtesy of listening. And this world, in order to really turn it around, has to listen with open ears to what's being said by those who can see what's going on, who are aware. It's a funny thing that the whole movement of tolerance is literally a movement of intolerance towards truth in this world. Towards salvation, towards choosing a new idea. It's literally intolerance, intolerant of that. And what it's saying is tolerate this intolerance. And what I'm saying, don't tolerate this intolerance. We have to tolerate the path of truth, towards truth, because we have to take that path. So we must have tolerance of it. And we must reject the intolerance of it. Literally, you might call this present day and age is the day and age of intolerance, because it does not tolerate those who point out the path toward of remembrance. It only tolerates those who are rejecting the path of remembrance. It only tolerates those who are trying to forget what they are, which is a mission of futility. So it's not really a mission at all. So we must reject this intolerance. But the fact is, the will to do it, I don't see the will to do it at all. Because if anyone speaks up and points out the intolerance that is being systematized and institutionalized here on this planet, there, the spin is able to twist that around, and they're termed intolerant. It's kind of like if you point out a criminal and we must not tolerate this criminal activity, and then the criminals turn that around on you and say, you're being intolerant by not tolerating our activity. You're the criminal. That's what's happened in this world. The criminals are in charge of this planet, and they are saying that those who do not tolerate this criminality, they're the criminals. They're the ones who should be criminalized. So it's upside down, backwards, inside out. And this is not a happy situation at all. It's not an interesting situation. It's a boring situation. It's very boring. There's no inspiration in it. There's nothing in it. It's flat. Forgetfulness of what we are is flat. It only seems to have depth by the progress and momentum it pushes. It has to push things through constantly in order to appear to have depth to it. It doesn't have any depth. It's all flat. But this constant progress change in that direction, change in a certain direction, gives an illusion of depth. So everybody says, hey, this civilization, we're making tolerance. We're making progress because we're tolerating all this criminality, this forgetfulness of what we are, this infiltration of this planet. We're tolerating it. That means we're progressing. We're becoming more tolerant. This absolute nonsense. How can becoming tolerant of criminality be something that we feel so self-righteous about? The things that the world tolerates now were criminal in the past. Absolutely criminal. And people didn't do it. Because they knew the consequences if they did. That they would lose their place in society. Society understood there's certain standards that needed to be kept in order to advance on the path of remembrance. These standards came from the basic scriptures and teachings that were started by very great beings who knew who they were, who remembered who they were. There have been a few of them throughout history. They set up a code of conduct, a code of ethics and morals and conduct, and they say you need to follow these so that you don't get seduced and pulled back on the path of forgetfulness. And then as you're following these codes of conduct, etc., you need to then pay attention towards clarification, listen to the voice of reason, and you progress in that way. And it works. But we, in our great folly of spiritual pride, have thrown those away, thinking that they're useless to us. And we're now celebrating, quote-unquote, our freedom, our liberation, as if we've been liberated from some kind of straitjacket of codes of conduct and morality, decency. As if somehow that's a good thing. We've been liberated from that. No, it's a terrible thing. It's a ruinous, reckless, heedless, drunk on pride, folly. And yet this is celebrated now in the world. And those who speak out remind us of what a terrible path this is, are seen as anachronisms, and even criminal, because they hate what's going on. You know, I hate what's going on in the world. Why can't people say that? What's wrong with that? Is that somehow unspiritual to say that? No, Jesus hated what the money changers were doing. Really hated it. It was intolerant of it. There's nothing says that peace comes through tolerance. No, peace comes through choosing a new idea and experiencing the effect of that idea, which is the overlay. We cannot manufacture the overlay. What the ego is telling us is we can manufacture the overlay through what it calls tolerance, that we don't need to choose a new idea with the effects of that idea. We don't need to experience that. We can keep the same idea of wanting to be prime creator, but we can manufacture tolerance. We can manufacture through laws and severe punishments of those who break the laws. And everybody has to be tolerant of forgetfulness of what we are. And that this tolerance is the overlay. It will bring love and peace to the planet. Not true. That's the big lie. That is the big, big, big lie. Doesn't work because people still are desperate to remember what they are. And the only way to remember what we are is to have an experience effect which is non-modifiable from the very beginning. That's effortlessly non-modifiable. Tolerance in this planet is held together through severe sanctions. People, I guarantee you, I speak to many, many people in all walks of life. I observe them, talk with them. People are terrified. I mentioned and say, hey, you know, if you say that, you're going to be, don't you dare say that. And people say, yeah, I know. We don't dare say what we feel or how we think in so many different ways, because our lives will be destroyed. So there's a facade of tolerance, and the ego claims that that's peace, that'll bring peace, that's the peace you're looking for. That's a lie. ego is a liar and deceiver from the very beginning. That's the very thing that doesn't work. Trying to force tolerance on the planet is not the way. It's the lying, deceiving way. The overlay is not tolerance. It's beyond that. The issue of tolerating something doesn't even arise at all. Because the effect of the idea of not trying to be prime creator is an idea of non-modification. There's nothing to be trying to be modified at all. There's no desire to modify anything. And this effect is unchanging. But we have ego misinterprets it and says, oh, this effect is tolerating everything. No, it's not. It's not even an issue of tolerance. It's overlaying everything. Overlaying is not the same thing as tolerance. It's the high indifference. In other words, it has the issue of whether it's tolerating or not is totally beside the point. The ego misinterprets what the remedy is and then tries to enforce this misinterpretation on the planet. As if you're supposed to tolerate wickedness and criminality, and if you don't, somehow that you're criminal and wicked. That's just craziness. I know there have been some spiritual teachers who are actually guided by the ego who have claimed that tolerance is peace. That's not true. That's the egoic religion. It's the egoic belief system. It's a false belief system. We're not speaking of intolerance so much as we are choosing to overlay. The overlay completely transcends the issue of tolerance or intolerance. So what we're really speaking here is to transcend the entire issue altogether. The overlay, the peace beyond understanding, isn't trying to be tolerant. It simply is being what it is, which is an effect which is not trying to modify itself. But that's just what it is. There's no issue of tolerance there. Those in this world who have had remembered what they are and experienced this overlay, they're not tolerating anyone, or they're not being intolerant, they're not being tolerant. Neither one. One could say they're being loving, but again, it transcends our understanding of that. It simply means that they are experiencing this effect of that's not being modified in any way. It's pristine, it's immaculate, it's not being changed, not being diminished, altered in any way. It's an immaculate effect, and they're simply experiencing that. And they're showing us that we can experience that effect too. The ego is constantly trying, through laws, through legal systems, the legal pressure, threats of having your life ruined, to impose some kind of overlay upon the planet, like let's everyone sing songs and be loving, etc. That is the ego's teaching. It's false teaching. The real gurus, the real saviors, the real teachers, those who remember what they are, who know what they are, they give a different attitude. They look out with this impartiality, but it's really, we mistranslate that. The ego mistranslates that to us. It guides us into mistranslation of what it is. I'm telling you, it's the overlay. They're experiencing the effect of a different idea. They're not someone who has overcome their intolerance and become a good person. That's not that at all. That's the ego is telling you that. Even some religions have had their interpretations have been formed by listening to the ego. So they think that a saint is someone who is manages to overcome their prejudices and tries to treat everybody kindly and equally, etc. That's not true. That's not a saint. A saint is someone who's chosen the new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. That's the only definition of a saint. And they're experiencing the effects of this, choosing this new idea, which is this blissful, boundless, immaculate peace beyond understanding, the seamless peace. Different teachers speak about it in different ways. The great space or the great nothingness. Pure nothingness, so to speak. In other words, we think of things as that which is being modified and changing and etc. pure nothingness is means nothing is being changed. Its effect is not being altered or changed. It's this infinite richness, pristineness, pure consciousness, pure awareness, pure spaciousness, immaculate beingness, etc. All of those definitions refer to the same effect. And this effect just is what it is. And experiencing this effect reminds us, spirit, of what it is. And that's the only purpose there is to this. That's all that spirit has to do, is remember what it is. The spirit is already perfect. Spirit doesn't have to overcome anything. Reality is immaculate, can't be harmed, life cannot harm itself. So the issue of intolerance or tolerance cannot even arise at all in reality. It's not that all things are tolerated. Attack isn't tolerated because there's no such thing as attack. There's no such thing as diminishment. There's no such thing as harm. So what is there to tolerate? It's not even an issue at all. Life cannot harm itself. So there is no issue of being tolerant. There's nothing that can harm life at all. Because there's no flesh. The kingdom of heaven is not based on flesh at all. It's not even based on energy. It's based on essence of idea, essence, pure beingness, pure isness. The ego doesn't have a clue about this. So the ego is desperately trying to catch our attention and attract us. We the ego knows we have this. We're attracted to something. It doesn't know what it is, so it tries to throw up all this gaudy kingdom of the flesh and say, "Here, be attracted to this." And we are attracted to it superficially. Our personalities are attracted to it. No doubt about it. Everyone has this sort of a sluggish, vague attraction to it. That's just a personality attracted to it. Spirit isn't attracted to it, not really. Spiritual pride is attracted to it. The desire to be prime creator sees this as a means to accomplish it. But it's not a real attraction. It's a flat attraction, which is no real attraction at all. Again, in order to maintain an illusion of attraction, there has to be a continual amplification and progression of this, you know, this sleaze, this decadence, this wickedness, this indecency, this frivolity. All of that has to increase all the time to give an impression that there's some depth to it. Ego can tell spirit, "Hey, look, there's depth to it, you know. You can keep going down that road." Whereas spirit is scratching its head and saying, "You know what? There doesn't seem to be depth to this. It seems very flat. It seems very unsatisfying. It doesn't seem to be where it's at." So why you see people get one tattoo, and then they get two, and they get 10, and they have their whole bodies covered. You know, you just gotta try to put depth to it, you know. But it's flat. It's flat. All this stuff. The Satan's kingdom, the extraterrestrials have brought all this stuff into this planet, all this technology. It's very flat. There's no depth to it. There's no real attraction to it at all. We don't feel attracted to it. And the ego knows this and is desperate to, you know, keep upping the stakes, keep doubling down. All the ego does is double down. That's all it can do. Which is why things go into catastrophe here. Because the ego keeps doubling down. Doesn't have any other way to proceed. Has to double down. Has to continuously double down on the bet. And where one doesn't satisfy, the ego says, "Let's build two." Where two doesn't satisfy, so "Let's build four. And let's build four casinos. Let's build 16. Let's build 32. Let's just keep doubling down more and more and more and more and more. And that we think, wow, you know, there's depth here. That's a cruel road that we go down. It's a road into, oh boy, destitution, a feeling of just incredible flatness. What happens is when you go down that road far enough, you reach a point where you literally feel this horrible malaise. There are extraterrestrials who have reached that, and they warned us. They warned this planet about this. There are some wise ones who know about this, who have been through this, and they say, "Don't go down this road because you will end up with this horrible malaise." Now, some who have got this malaise are wrongly thinking that human emotion and drama can bring them out of this flatness. It's not true. Let me put this in perspective. There's different groups of extraterrestrials on this planet, with different agendas. Some are trying to heal themselves from this terrible malaise that they've got. What happens, you go down the road, the ego doubles down, takes you down this road that seems to be depth to it, but there is none. Eventually, you feel so flat, so unenriched, you feel like you don't have any spirit anymore. It's a horrible feeling. You don't know what's wrong. You just feel like something's so terribly wrong, and there's no more richness in your life. It's gone. Everything's gone. Everything's just completely flat, and it's horrifying, terrifying. You don't know what caused it. You don't know how you got into it. You just know you got to find a way out of it. And so there again, though, many turn to the ego and say, how do I get out of this? Well, the ego's the one that led you into it. So the ego certainly can't lead you out of it. What the ego does is just loops you back into emotion and drama and all that, and just presents another flat road that seems to have a mirage of depth to it. And so many ETs are focusing on this planet of human emotion, trying to stir up all sorts of drama here because it makes them feel less flat. They feel less flat, at least they think they do. But the truth is they're just going down the same old road. Once again, they'll find themselves back in the same predicament again, chasing after mirages of depth. There's no real depth in a mirage, it's flat. But it looks like it's depth. Looks like it has depth. It's an illusion. The kingdom of flesh has an illusion of depth to it. And it leads to this dreadful feeling of flatness eventually, which then the ego prescribes more of the same. Just chase a different mirage. I'll tell you the truth, that music itself is flat. Music is a great mirage. Because it seems to have depth to it. It's one of the most potent mirages there is, and I've been involved in that, actually producing these mirages, believing that I was producing depth. I was really very adept at giving the illusion of depth to music. But it's a mirage, it's flat. Young people are extremely susceptible to music, and so the ETs used music as a way to get into the young people of this planet. And then using that music, they're able to guide young people into more severe mirages, more damaging, more very, very bad mirages that had more of a stronger attraction, kind of. It's all bundled together. But music seems to be less damaging than the other mirages, but it's not, because it really helps attach one to other mirages. It's like the window dressing that gets one into the shop. It's like the frame around this very dark picture. So I certainly deeply regret having ever worked on music at all. But I was in delusion. All musicians are in delusion. Really, they really are. I know the field of music like very few know it. I know it through and through, highs and lows, every bit, everything about it, really. And all musicians are in a state of delusion because they think they're producing depth and they're not. They don't realize that's not the way. They don't realize that their music is then used by the ego to glamorize and beautify and dress up more wicked illusions of depth. It's used in advertising everything, right? You produce some song that seems to have great depth to it, and 20 years later it's selling cars or selling something. It's part of a campaign to hook people into technology. And the musicians are tearing their hair out, saying, I never intended it for it to be used that way. That's happens all the time. It gets used for bumper music for something, you know. It gets used as a theme for a television show. Musician loses the rights. Most musicians don't have the rights to their music. Publisher owns the rights. Someone else owns the rights. And the publisher sells the music to the highest bidder. So the musicians get used, okay, in this world. The ego just uses them. uses them as much as it can use them and then discards them in the trash heap. When you're not useful anymore as a musician, ego could care less about you, dumps you. If you can't provide the illusion of depth, then you're useless to the ego. So when you can, when you're very adept at producing this illusion of depth, then you're the hero. The ego thinks you're the, you know, hero, great hero. But when you start seeing through it and say, wow, there's no depth to this really, or you lose your capacity, someone else is better, the ego doesn't even recognize that you exist. It denies you ever existed. You're nothing. You're zero to the ego. Zero. So you go from being a hero to a zero. And you don't even know what happened. You suddenly, you're out of favor with what you thought was God. It's not the ego. This producing an illusion of depth is not God. It's the ego who's guiding us in that. And so we fall out of favor with the ego. We feel like we've fallen out of favor with God. And we think we've been forsaken. Nobody helps. Nothing steps up to help us. Nobody helps us. Lost and forgotten. I've been through all of this. Where is God? We don't see it anywhere. But God is not so easy to find, because God is literally simply telling us we need to choose a new idea. It's not to be found in the world at all. It's only to be found, remembered, in experiencing the overlay of this world. The seamless overlay. That's the only way God is to be found. Because it's the only way we can remember what we are. And then we'll remember what we are. We remember that the Prime Creator created us. That's the only way. Cannot be found in this world. So, yet the ego, it tells us that we can. And we're all working on illusions of depth. It's all mirages. Even the best musicians are only producing mirages. And I was trained in all sorts of ways. Even in this life, was trained even more and more and more in how to provide even better, more brilliant depth. I got into vocals, vocalization. Went through extreme training in that, being able to sing in amazing ways. I can sing in ways better than the vocalists that you're hearing. But that is actually, again, providing an illusion of depth, which is a mirage. I used to just sing to myself to entertain myself, because I could sing better than these other singers. When I'm not trying to sing for others, then I don't feel so guilty. I'm just providing an illusion, a mirage of depth to myself. Then I can just do things, amazing things. But I tell you this, it's ultimately, it's flat. It's a mirage. I don't care how great you sing. If you're waiting around, waiting for a great singer to come into the world, you're wasting your time, because it doesn't matter how great the singer is. Because it will still be flat. You know, when Elvis came along, everybody thought, wow, here's real depth. Here's real depth, you know. The Beatles came along, here's real depth. You know, and those who rejected that, they said, no, you can find depth in country music. You know, they got real depth there. You got Brenda Lee or George Jones, real depth there. Or people rejected that and they went to soul music, you know. Motown. Motown has depth. It's got soul. That's what, when they say it has soul, it means it has depth. So, you know, each generation, young people listen to this music, they're looking for depth. The 60s, the 50s, 60s, 70s, unbelievable music. I mean, these people are very skilled at providing illusion of depth. You had great folk music. You had all different types of this. You had instrumental music. Really, you know, fabulous instrumental backing for the singers. Great singers. Great instrumental backing. Very sophisticated. You had the Beach Boys. I thought they were the most sophisticated of all at providing illusion of depth. Really. I was smitten by them because I said, these are real geniuses at providing, at doing what musicians do best, is providing an illusion of depth. They were the best, in my opinion. They knocked me out, you know. I said, they actually knocked my will out because I was trying to avoid being a musician in this life. But when I heard the Beach Boys, I said, oh my gosh, it's like some unbelievable confection. Let's say you've sworn off sweets and you see this confection that is so artfully put together. You just say, oh my gosh, I've got to try that one. And then as soon as you try that one, the sweet tooth comes back, and before you know it, you're eating all the chocolates. Exactly what happened to me. I even remember the song that caused it, I Get Around by the Beach Boys. It was a brilliant, brilliant song as far as giving this a simple illusion of depth, but in a way it was just brilliantly done, and I couldn't help but admire it. I said, wow, this is real musical genius. Brian Wilson, musical genius, really. Unfortunately, it led me astray. And so musicians have got to rethink what they're doing, because I tell you that music has the power, it leads more people astray than anything. Beautiful, great music leads people astray, because a lot of people, they don't want to be led astray. They don't want to focus on illusions anymore. And here comes this incredibly brilliant song, and people say, oh, I can't resist. And then comes that sweet tooth, and they start indulging in illusions of depth. It's exactly what happened to me. Happens to a lot of people, a lot of us. We don't even realize it. I was aware of it. I felt myself falling, you know, falling into illusion of depth. I lost my clarity at that point. And then I studied. I tried to see, how can I improve upon this? And I eventually was able to get even better illusion of depth than the Beach Boys. I was able to figure out how it's done, you know. But at that time, different illusions of depth came into the world. Very crude stuff. Very crude. Crude, rude music. And, you know, the beautiful confections, you know, were no longer in vogue. It was like junk food, you know, junk music. You know, it was very upsetting. Horrible. Because the illusion of depth dried up. And, I mean, to some people, it still satisfies. It gives an illusion of depth. But to those who demand a very sophisticated illusion of depth to keep in a state of forgetfulness of what they are, the music of today, you know, is like nothing. It's flat. For me, the music of today is so flat. It's so flat that I, you know, just don't even bother with it. I go back to the music of the 60s. Some of that stuff is, you can listen to it and you say, holy cow, they really were sophisticated at that time. But again, being sophisticated is not a good thing. Because you lead people astray that way. Same thing with beautiful movies. All artists give an illusion of depth. That's what we do. Been there and done that. There are many, many who are masterful at that. I used to be masterful at that. And if I turned my attention that direction, I still could be. But I know that that actually leads people astray. It leads me astray. It has terrible consequences. Horrible. And it causes all sorts of conflict. People argue. You know, the idea, the ego tells us that music will bring the world together. Nothing could be further from the truth. If you want to find out, if you want to see conflict, go on to YouTube and look at, pull up some song, you know, in like a guitar, a power, you know, guitar song or something, and read all the arguments on there. Someone says, nah, this guitarist is the best guitarist, and people are like, you're crazy, you know, this one's better, this one's no good, and the arguments get intense. People get into tremendous arguments over music, What has greater depth is what they're arguing about. Because each one has a different perspective, and each one finds the illusion of depth that they're looking for. And so they, when they find a favorite artist, they say, this artist gives me this illusion of depth, and anybody else speaks ill of them, oh man. That is like, they feel greatly insulted and upset over that. So music brings tremendous conflict in the world because people have intense tastes in that. You know, it's important to them. Illusion of depth is important to the ego. And to those who are trying to forget what they are, illusion of depth is all important. And so they take it very seriously. I remember I was in charge of music at the high school during lunch, and I played what I felt was music that had great depth to it. Nobody else liked it. They just ignored it. They didn't even listen to it. Because for them, it didn't have the depth they were looking for. I played stuff that was very intense. For me, that provided the illusion of depth at that time. But for others, it didn't provide the illusion they were looking for. So I found out that music is very personal. Most personal thing. Politics, religion, music, etc. All of those things that provide illusion of depth, whatever it may be. People are very, very personal about that, and they get very upset if that's challenged. Because to them, they literally feel their salvation depends upon it. There's illusion of depth. So really, all art, all that stuff should be rejected, to tell you the truth. Shouldn't be our focus at all. Shouldn't be praised. We shouldn't have these superstars. Should not. Should be ignored. Just ignore them. You know, that should be the collective will of the planet. Because providing illusion of depth is not where it's at. But it's like second nature to us to provide illusions of depth. So we cannot be overly judgmental of that, or overly harsh. But we don't have to be overly harsh. We can just ignore it. We don't have to buy any of these songs. We don't have to pay attention. We don't have to listen to them. I tell you this, there are artists, there are those who are capable of producing music that's way better than what we have now, but they're not doing it, and I'm one of those. If that was really my purpose, and I decided to sell out to the ego, I could produce music way, way better than what people are listening to now. Much, much more sophisticated and beautiful, and a much better illusion of depth. I could orchestrate it all. I could run a whole music label. Could do anything in the field of music. I could do it. I'm sure there are other people like that. Just because you have a talent to produce an illusion of depth doesn't mean you should use that talent. A real judge of someone is what don't they do? Not what they do, what don't they do? What do they refrain from doing? Are they refraining from producing an illusion of depth? That's what's really to be praised in this world. That's why I say, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall... You'll see the kingdom, meaning blessed are those who are not working on providing an illusion of depth in this world, for they will find the true depth. Poor in spirit means they're not trying to be sophisticated, not trying to produce an illusion of depth. This world praises and enriches those who are sophisticated at that, who can build the beautiful buildings, do the beautiful artwork, in many, many ways provide this illusion of depth that we feel that there's some richness here. So we're attracted to it. See, what illusion of depth does, it gives us a focus for our feeling of attraction. We have this feeling we're attracted to something, and we're not sure what it is. And here's this illusion of depth, and we say, this is what I'm attracted to. This song, that's what it is. And we don't realize what we're really attracted to is remembering what we are, a spirit. We're attracted to remember what we are. But these illusions of depth delay us. And we say, no, I want to listen to this song. I said, well, it's a great song. I still do it. We all do it. I know that I'm in trouble when I'm listening to a song. I know I've got off track. Even though it's just a really great down-to-earth song, you know, it's still off track. There's no real depth there. Real depth is in experiencing the idea and an effect that is not being modified. And we don't see that as depth. We see that as the opposite of depth, because we're used to illusions of depth. We're used to changing, modifications, providing an illusion of depth. But actual depth comes in remembering what we are, because we're infinite depth. We have access to all ideas, infinite depth. That is what true depth is, and only by remembering what we are do we actually recover that depth and are aware of that depth, that true depth of what we are. And only by experiencing an idea that is an effect that is non-modifiable, which in that effect comes from the idea of not trying to become prime creator. Only by experiencing this idea, the effect of this idea, a seamless, non-modifiable effect, only that way do we remember what we are. It's like only by experiencing nothingness do we remember what we are, and that is true depth. So again, we equate change and process with depth. That's an illusion of depth. If we could just realize that nothingness, that the true depth will dawn upon us when we experience this nothingness, meaning no changingness. We're not stitching together parts. Music is all these notes stitched together, okay? But in nothingness, there are no notes being stitched together. There's just this oneness. And it's really infinite richness. It reminds us of this infinite richness that we are. And so we struggle with this, believing that depth and richness comes from sophisticated modification, not from non-modification. You know, great songs have to do with clever modifications. Like the Beach Boys, they were very clever at the modifications they used. They used modifications you didn't expect in certain sequences that were unexpected, very sophisticated and clever. And that threw us into a feeling of like, wow, there's incredible depth here. But it's all self-referencing. It's all based on modification, based on what our expectations are, etc. It has nothing to do with remembering what we are. It just throws us off the scent of what we are. And we're very clever at throwing ourselves off the scent of what we are. Very clever indeed. But again, this is not to be praised. I actually criticized a lot of the music when I was growing up. I criticized the Beatles a lot because I knew what they were up to. They were playing everybody for fools, to tell you the truth. That whole situation, just playing everyone for fools. And that really spearheaded one of the main pushes of forgetfulness on this planet was the Beatles. But they had precursors too, really. Elvis was another one. But there were many, many, many. The whole music industry, the whole entertainment industry was dedicated to providing illusion of depth, always has been. The Beatles just were very opportunistic. They were very, very opportunistic. They saw the opportunity, they knew how to exploit it, and they went for it. And that opened up a whole nother realm of illusion of depths, all different types of different illusions of depth that we had not used for a while. But the truth is, everything we're experiencing is just being recycled. You know, Jimi Hendrix came along and played guitar like in a way that we've never heard before. And it was like, wow, incredible depth here. You know, people were just smitten by it. And that gave rise then to the whole, you know, psychedelic era and the illusion of depth that drugs and music combined gave. Again, all flat. All of that. The drugs and the music of the time. We call it sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And what that did was it gave an illusion of depth that we were not used to. So we're very vulnerable to that. Because in the 50s and early 60s, of course, you didn't have the sex, drugs, and rock and roll in that way. You had torch songs, you know, just emotionalism, sorrow, breaking up, you know. She doesn't love me, he doesn't love me. When will I see you again? You know, all this kind of just relationship, kind of puppy love relationship stuff. And then the psychedelic era came in and a whole different style of illusion. And then that gave way to the heavy metal style of illusion, depth there in the Sturm und Drang kind of heavy metal stuff, you know, super intense, robotic. That gave rise to high-tech music, digital music. You know, going through music goes through phases, but that's all. Everything's just being recycled. I've been there and done that. Before, you had classical music, which gave illusion, great illusion of depth, still does for many. And then you gave way to big bands, orchestration. You know, that way gave illusion of depth. Music keeps cycling along, keeps changing, always has to, because we get used to it. It turns flat. It's like stale beer, you know. It's flat. Say, pour us a new one. Give us something new. Mix it up. You know, 60s, we mixed it all up. Had everything. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. That was the mantra of the times. Everyone was as high as a kite. And listening to music and saying, wow, there's so much depth there. You know, unbelievable. I never heard it before. It's incredible depth. Man, where's the depth now? It's just an illusion. Modification doesn't have any real depth at all. Reality doesn't function through modification. Reality is expansion, extension of what is. What is not modified, it's extended. That's how creation works, manifested. Everything's manifested as an extension. But what has already been manifested remains exactly as it is. No modification taking place whatsoever. It's a different, very different than existence. And so the high culture of existence isn't just an illusion. All of existence is an illusion of depth. There's no depth to it at all. None. We look out and we see the ocean. We see the sky. We see people. All this stuff. It seems so rich and so much depth. There's no depth to it at all. It's all an illusion. That's called the great illusion. And really at the forefront of it is music. Music is really utilized. And those who are expert musicians, black musicians, magicians, they are trying to monopolize music. Okay? They want all music to go through them, and they want to be the portal through which all this vast entertainment complex is channeled through this portal. And this is the illusion of depth. It's called black magic or magic. But it's just the ego providing an illusion of depth. And the desire to control the planet. If you want to control the planet, control the music. Because music is so important to young people. It's a drug, the most powerful drug there is. It's the one thing that young people should stay away from, actually. But if you look at YouTube, you can see music gets just unbelievable amount of views. Can't resist it. Youth cannot resist music. Most youth cannot. Very few can. Like I said, I even fell victim to it, even knowing, trying not to. Because I had a hand in it, you know. I've listened to so much music, and listen to music, I say, maybe I can use that, maybe I can use that. How can I, you know, produce better, more beautiful illusions of depth? That's a musician. That's what we do. But I've seen through it, and I say, even though I still have that tendency, I've seen through it, and I can say these things now. still looking for that perfect song. You know, maybe there's some song out there that is just like perfect, and the illusion of depth will be so perfect that I'll lose my desire to be attracted to something, because I'll say, ah, I found it, I finally found it, I found depth. What happens when you get into that situation? You end up eventually stagnating and then feeling completely flat, and you realize, oh my gosh, I didn't have any depth at all. And then you frantically go looking for some more illusions of depth, or you start waking up, you start listening to the voice of reason. Holy Spirit, divine grace, and that will inform you of what's going on. But the coming to realize it is a slow process. At least for me, it's been a slow process, because I was so heavily invested I was so adept at producing illusion of depth. And I was such the favorite child of the ego, because I could do this. It's a hard thing to do to let go of that, because you've tasted like the mountaintop, you know, and you think, oh, I want to get there again. All I have to do is produce, you know, some illusion of depth. But the thing is, trends change, and what worked as an illusion at one point, the ego says, ah, that doesn't work very good anymore. We got to do this style now. And then as a musician, you cannot do that style, because it's an offense to you, and you don't feel it. You're not able to do it. And so the ego just drops you. It says, ah, you cannot give, you know, the style that's needed now. Different style. And then you become nothing. And then you want to get back to that mountaintop. You want to get back feeling like you're important, that you're helping the world. So it's very tough for very skilled artists who have reached the mountaintop. They have a very rough time to turn towards truth. So they do it reluctantly, because they feel that they're giving up so much. They don't want to realize that they're only producing an illusion of depth, and it was really nothing at all. Because if they feel like, wow, I'm never going to be popular again. Music is brutal industry, because once you lose your popularity, you know, you can really just fall off the edge of the world. You're nothing. You have a hit, a big hit, and then you're forgotten. My gosh, I've seen horrible things with musicians. They can't let go. To their grave, they bring it with them to their grave. They can't stand the fact that they, you know, they're no longer popular. They keep thinking, you know, they just, why? I'm still very talented at what I do, and yet the ego has pulled the rug out from underneath me. My label has dropped me. My sales have gone down. No more reviews. No one's interested in me anymore. That's how it works. Brutal. Brutal, brutal industry. The truth of it is so unglamorous. It's just amazing. And of course, there are a few hardcore who do whatever the ego wants them to do. They got no conscience. They're shameless. And they manage to stay on top. They manage to keep for a long time, because they're willing to sell out all the way. But if you have a conscience and you want to sleep at night, at some point you say, oh, wait a minute, you know, I have my standards. I got a line. I'm not going to cross that line. That's asking too much of me. And when that happens, the ego gets unbelievably angry at you. I've experienced that. The ego asked me to do something. I said, no, forget it. You know, I can't be bought. I've got some dignity. I've got a conscience. And the ego just blew up, you know, that ruptured the relationship there completely. I mean, just the ego just could not believe that I would not do what I was told to do. Blew the ego's mind completely, and just melted down, complete meltdown on me. It's frightening. Because what you thought was God giving the right guidance, he's having a complete meltdown, just completely losing it. Absolutely furious, beyond homicidal, you know, just a wrath that is cannot even explain. The wrath is so severe, because literally, you know, I didn't realize, I just said no, I'm not doing it, and I didn't realize that this means, to the ego, it means, hey, this is goodbye, you're out, You're nothing anymore. You're nothing to me. You're useless. Ego doesn't like to do that because it wants to keep using you. Because that's all it's got. Providing illusion of depth is all ego's got. And when someone who was once so skilled at that, that the ego thought, hey, this guy is really going to succeed, is going to bring about a perfect illusion of depth that will cause spirit to be prime creator and completely forget what it is and be prime creator. The ego thought, yeah, I could do it, really believe I could do it. And when I said, nah, forget it. I'm not going down that road anymore. That just, the ego, you know, blew its mind. It says, you just freaked out. Because the ego then realized that maybe someone else will do the same later. We'll say, forget it. I've got my conscience. This is not the way. I'm not going to sell myself out completely that way. Because the ego just keeps asking for more and more and more stuff. And it has no conscience. Wickedness, depravity. It'll insist that you do whatever it asks you to do. You have to use that to try and provide depth. And it just thinks that you're some kind of slave that will just, who has skills of adding illusion of depth, and you're willing to use it in any way, in any way. No matter, and eventually you realize, hey, wait a minute, this is getting me in a heap of trouble. Ego doesn't care. Ego says, I'll just buy your way out of it, you know. I mean, as long as you keep doing what the ego wants you to do, you're Teflon coated. A lot of these artists get away with anything. Because ego's protecting them. If you're willing to sell your soul to the devil will protect you from lawsuits and criminality and all that stuff. Definitely will protect you from that. But as soon as you say, wait a minute, I've got some standards here and I'm not going to do anything you want, then the ego will drop its protection of you. And then you seem to be at the mercy of the wolves of the world and you can't get anywhere. In fact, the ego will block you from any success. The ego hates you now, you know, because the ego can't trust you. The ego says, ah, you turn your back on me, and now I can't trust you anymore. So I don't want to hear anything from you. The ego doesn't want to be tempted to use you again once it's dropped you. It says you'll never work in this town again, period. And it carries a grudge infinitely. Once you're on the outs with it, no way can you get back in the good graces. You cannot. So basically, you feel like you're forsaken. I can testify to this, absolutely testify to this, direct experience. And then you look for God. Where's God really? Because the ego, you thought the ego was God. Now, the ego's forsaken you, and you realize you'll never get in the good graces of the ego again. It's impossible. You've betrayed the ego. Ego cannot trust you. You're untrustworthy now. And you say, well, what did I do that's so bad? You know, no, it's useless. Useless. So then you need to listen to truth. You need to hear the voice of truth, experience reality, a glimpse of it, which is what happened to me. I experienced reality, got a glimpse of reality, and trying to find out what happened, I came across and was willing to take a look at reality for just a moment, because I was in such anguish of being rejected by the ego. And I saw reality. I said, well, wait a minute. Whoa. I don't need the ego. What do you mean? All this is illusion. This is delusion. An illusion of depth here in this world. Don't even need it. Because reality is there waiting for me. At that point, then, I turned against the ego and really started to investigate and unravel the entire situation and see through the delusions and the false belief system of the ego. Now the ego really doesn't like me. And it's a tough road. It's a tough road in this world for many. Some seem to have a slightly easier road, but I tell you, anyone who's reached stardom, who has been in a favored position in this world, has a very tough road. That's why I counsel right now, you know, drop that sophistication. It's not needed. in any sophistication you come up with, someone can do better. So I'd say to the stars, don't think you're so great. Like I said, if I wanted to, if my soul was conformed to it, I could sing better than anyone really is doing right now. I could produce better music. But I won't do it. So people should not think, wow, I'm really talented, I'm really great. There are others who could produce better stuff if they wanted to, but they say, no, forget it. Forget it. It's not worth it. It's not worth selling your soul to the devil, to the ego. Not worth seeing the ego as God to just so that you can have some fame and fortune. That's a horrible path. And those who really know are not impressed, you know. I can listen to great singers, I do, because they're so talented at what they do. But in the back of my mind, I say, well, yeah, that's good. I can do just as good or better. So what's the big deal? It's not that big of a deal. I'm not even doing it. So it's really not that important. I used to record music and just erase it. Just let it go. Did a lot of that. Really, I used to produce incredible music when I was into digital electronic music, and just I really could do, but I don't have any of that. I erased it all, threw it all away. It's on, digital storage, and I just erased it all. Sometimes I think, if I only had that song, I could put it into this context. You know, I was practicing producing for like advertising stuff and just super catchy types of music that was just had this wonderful illusion of depth to it. But no marketing ever arose for it. I threw it all in the garbage. Same thing with a lot of video special effects. I was very, very talented at that, using like Adobe After Effects and Photoshop and producing this, you know, gorgeous, gorgeous stuff. And what happened? I threw all that in the dumpster one day. I took all my tapes and I made like about 55 videos, sophisticated on videos at that time with music and everything. And one day, I had copies all, one day I took them all to this dumpster, threw them all in the dumpster. Everything. I don't have any of that. Don't have a single copy of any of that stuff I did. And for its time, it was very sophisticated. Some of it used spiritual themes to provide illusion of depth that was just entrancing, stunning. Again, threw it all away. I don't have any copies of it anywhere. Junked it. So, when people come out with sophisticated stuff, like in commercials and stuff, I could do all that stuff. All the sophisticated commercials and the way they do things, I knew how to do all that. If I wanted to, I could do it even better. But I decided, nope, let's just throw it all away, because that's not the path. That's not the right path. So when you're being creative, etc., you know, some moment will come to you and you need to realize, wait a minute, I don't want to waste my life doing this. Forget it. And maybe you think you can sell all this stuff. I never made a penny on anything I did. No takers. I guess the Holy Spirit was protecting me. And so I just said, forget it. Now I put everything in Creative Commons. Nonprofit, share alike, Creative Commons. That's one way to deal with the temptation. I'm trying to get less sophisticated here on these satsangs, because my eyes are burning out. And this is very important, because there's creative people everywhere. We're inherently creative. And what we really are sophisticated and ingenious and clever. And we look at other cleverness of people and we say, I can do better than that. I can be more clever than that. Like when I listen to a song, I'm able to transpose the song and make it even better. It's very easy. I can do that. But then again, what good is that cleverness? What good is it doing me? It's providing an illusion of depth that I'm attracted to. So I can forget about being attracted to actually choosing a new idea, which is what the saints, the saviors, the avatars, the gurus, tell us we must do, and they have done themselves. We get pulled away from that. We think we are finding depth in music, even spiritual music. Chanting, I've heard it all. There's no depth, no real depth to it. That's not it. Even the greatest music ever produced has no real depth to it. It's not. It doesn't help us remember what we are. Not really. It gives us an illusion that we think we're remembering what we are, or we think we're close to remembering what we are, or we think we're closer, but we're not. It's flat. So the real path is to say, not this, not this, not this. This doesn't work, this doesn't work, this doesn't work. Even this great song doesn't work. Even this great artist doesn't work. You could have, in satsang, you could have the most beautiful singer in the world. And they could be singing the most soulful, spiritual music in the world with the most beautiful flutes in the background, whatever. Doesn't bring you close to what you are. It's flat. It's nothing. You can say, not this. I just spent some days listening to some music of the 60s that I'd never really listened to before. Brenda Lee, very talented, and the orchestration was very sophisticated. And I listened to all those songs, and most of them I've never heard before. They're actually very popular in the early 60s. Great, 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 great singer. And the songwriters and instrumentation, the arrangements are superb. And literally, I felt nothing. I mean, these are torch songs. Just absolutely tug at your emotions. I felt nothing. Nothing at all. I had no reaction to it. I recognized how the brilliance of illusion of depth there, but as far as a reaction, I didn't react. I had no reaction to it. There's no sentiment there, because I know it's not it. It's not it. I can listen to the, you know, the most spiritual type of music with the sitar and the harmonium and the chanting and the singing, etc. No reaction. I have no reaction to it. None really. It's flat. The only reaction is a flat reaction. It's flat. Because I know there's no depth there. Can see it. And the music is desperately, you know how a song will get in your mind and keep playing over and over and over and over. That's the ego. The ego is desperately trying to attract you to this music by saying, hey, there's depth. Come here. There's depth here. Look here. Look in music. You will find what you're looking for there. Don't go to this nothingness. Don't go to this vision of Christ, this vision of oneness. There's no depth there. The ego keeps telling you, there's no depth there. But that's not true, because it the dawn of remembrance of what we are starts right there. And what we are is depth. See, here we think we're having depth or think we're seeing depth, but what we actually are is depth. Whereas we think we're something other than depth, experiencing depth through music. We're the listener experiencing the music, experiencing the depth. That's false. That's flatness. What we are as spirit is depth. Literally is the depth itself. Very different. Night and day difference. The ego doesn't know this. So it will keep singing that siren song to you. And keep glamorizing it. Keep putting on fashion shows, you know, to attract you to this. That's the kingdom of the flesh. One vast fashion show. Kingdom of the glitterati. Decadent. Wallowing in this non-stop fashion show. And every kind of music possible. Constantly calling to us. That's the siren song. That is the siren song. It's really calling us to deep forgetfulness of what we are. It's attracting us. Trying to make forgetfulness attractive to us. Every style imaginable gets trotted out. And when we get bored of that style, ones that we haven't seen in a long time get recycled. And we get bored of that, what do we do then? Well, then we start listening to truth and say, wait a minute, maybe there's something to this nothingness, this pure spaciousness. Maybe there's something there. Start considering it. And that's when we get into satsang. So these things need to be said, because if you're into satsang, it's because you're bored. You're seeing through it. You're seeing the flatness of existence. And something within you is saying, wait a minute, this could get really bad. What happens if I see through all of it? I don't get the feeling, that feeling anymore, that emotion. Emotion is flat. Reactions, sentiment, reactions to all these things are flat. Drama is flat. That's not real depth at all. Isness is depth. Modification is not depth. So eventually all these tricks of the ego to wring emotion out of you, wring cheap thrills out of you, gets flat. And you start saying, well, wait a minute. I've been down that road before. I know it's flat. And you say, well, wait a minute. You start catching the ego in all its tricks and say, I don't know. That doesn't work. I know that. So not this. And then you get an existential crisis where you say, wait a minute. None of this stuff works. None of this is going to work for me. What do I do? You know, it's scary. That's when you pay attention to satsang. That's when you find a teacher. I found a teacher. Very interesting situation. Found several teachers actually in crisis points, but at the same time the ego tried to use those teachers to generate an illusion of depth. The very same time, that's what happened. And the ego says, oh, that's great, you found this great teacher. Okay, here's how we can use this great teacher now to provide illusion of depth. And then I said, huh, maybe it can be used to help people out, you know, that kind of thing. Got pulled into that. So as you find a teacher in satsang, there's also, going along with that, the ego will tell you, hey, you're so fortunate to find this teacher. Look at all the ways you can produce depth now with this teacher. You can really get a lot of emotions and a lot of sentiment out of this situation. You can really produce a lot of illusion of depth here. And that's what most people do with the teacher. That's why the teacher gets frustrated. Says, nobody comes to me and really interested in truth. They're only interested in, you know, pursuing this illusion of depth and using me for that purpose. And the teacher gets so frustrated with that, kind of disappointed, because that's what happens. But when, if you're attracted to satsang, it's because in the back of your mind, you're saying, whoa, wait a minute, I could be headed for some trouble, because I may run out of tricks. I mean, everything may become flat for me. What do I do then? Well, you need to choose a new idea. And the effect of that, you need to start considering this nothingness, this vision of oneness, this perfect seamlessness, this overlay, this nirvana, this non-moving, this non-modification, this effect of non-modification, this effect that's not being modified in any way. We need to start seeing that that may be vastly preferable to an illusion of depth. We need to start looking at that possibility, because that's our only hope. Literally, it's your only hope. Because boredom can hit you, flatness can hit you. When I say boredom, flatness. Flatness hit me, terrible. It's the worst feeling ever. There's no depth. You have no feeling of depth at all. And it's horrifying. So that drives you to consider, where can I find real depth? Because the ego's depth has failed me. It's really just a mirage. So where can I find real depth? And that leads then to satsang, consideration of this. Consideration of choosing a different idea, experiencing the effect of that idea. Readjusting our sights. Is perfect nothingness, is that really flatness? Is non-modification really flatness? See, that's the worry we have. That's what trips us as we think, oh, nothing will be happening. I'll be so bored. It's all flat. But is perfect flatness, is that really boring? That is the question. Is perfect nothingness, no modification? What happens is it rings a bell. The bell of remembrance. The bell of real light, remembering that we are depth itself. And this depth itself cannot be modified. So this nothingness is not an end in itself. It's like a perfect mirror. The perfect mirror is necessary to see what we are. In other words, a mirror that is not being modified in any way provides the perfect reflection. Whereas we're used to looking into a mirror that the mirror itself is being constantly modified to provide an illusion of depth. And yet when we look into a mirror that's not being modified in any way, that mirror allows the reflection of what we really are to be seen. It's like that. It's not a trick. So that's why Satsang talks about emphasis is on this nothingness, this non-changingness, this non-modificationness, this mirror that is not being modified in any way. Now, if we were just looking at a mirror that was not being modified anyway, and that's all that it was, then it would be totally flat, I guess you could say that. But the fact is that this mirror of non-modification allows what we are to be seen perfectly, reflected perfectly. Because what we are can't be modified. So only a mirror that's not being modified can provide the true reflection of what we are. And in seeing what we are, that we experience infinite depth and infinite riches. So that's how it works. So that's why this satsang took place here. I didn't know where I was going with all of this, but it ended up in a great place. And hopefully, having this a cable connection means that we'll be able to upload this now. And indeed, it's still here. So, okay, very great. Hopefully you'll be able to watch this, and you had a very insightful time here, because I know it was very insightful for me to share this with you, so share some of my personal history with you, stretching back a long ways in history. I've had many, many incarnations, and been misled, as everyone is in this world, by the ego, then had to see through this false guidance of the ego. And how the ego will use even our connections with true spiritual teachers, the ego will still use that to deceive us by making us work on trying to provide depth through music and through presentations, etc. False depth, instead of listening to what the teacher is really saying. So all of this it needs to be brought to light by someone who's willing to do it. Who's not so afraid of the ego, you know, so they can just bring it out to light, and you can consider this. Keep open ears to this and hear it. In the back of your mind, you're saying, okay, this is important, because what if I reach this flatness and nothing moves me anymore, really, and I see it's all just an illusion, it just caused me misery and delay, what'll happen then? And you say, you know, I remember the teachings about choosing a new idea and experiencing the effect of non-modification, an effect that's not being modified, a perfect mirror reflecting what I really am, and that will be true riches then, and that's the only way to escape this problem that I'm in. That's in the back of your mind because you had open ears and you heard it. So attending the satsang, it has value in the long run. It has value, probably even in the short run, it's going to have a lot of value. You may not waste your time so badly anymore trying to provide an illusion of depth. You'll hear it's okay not to do that. It's okay not to follow your creativity. Very important not to do that, but rather focus on satsang, focus on truth, focus on seeing that this perfect mirror is not really flatness, because it reflects depth perfectly. Okay? Focus on that. Don't worry too much about your creativity. You can't really, no one expects you to drop it entirely. Just stop emphasizing it so much. Okay, very great. We reached a 2-hour time on this video. Okay, that's it.